Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. We have a contact button. I answer all my emails and give us a good review on Amazon. Give us a good review on Amazon. No, do all your shopping via iTunes. No, give... I haven't done this in a while. How does it go again? Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We get a small percentage of everything you buy. And after you do that, hit the contact button and tell me that you shopped on Amazon so I can thank you. And go to iTunes. Give us a good review, or on Stitcher or on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel, by the way. It's just audio. What else should I ask you to do? I haven't been asking you to do anything. What else are they supposed to do? Oh, donate. Become a monthly subscriber. We could always use financial support. Maybe one day I won't have to work. I could just do this. Wouldn't that be nice? Well, if everybody went to davidfeldmanshow.com and donated a dollar, I wouldn't have to work. Everybody who listens to this show, if you just went to davidfeldmanshow.com, gave me a dollar a week or a dollar a month, I could just do this show. If everybody who listened did that. If everybody who listened gave me $1 billion, I would go away forever and never come back. And that's a promise. If there's anybody out there who has $1 billion they want to unload, give it to me. And I'll go away. You'll never hear from me. All right. Been getting a lot of emails from last week's show. Most of it positive. There were two, I'll go with a positive. There were two parts of Friday's show that got a lot of response. One is everybody thanked me for my summation of the Mueller report. And I agree with you because I gave you all the highlights, all the important stuff that you needed to know. You're welcome. I'm not being arrogant. I didn't read the Mueller report. I skimmed it, and then I went through the coverage, and I put together what I thought was a precis on the Mueller report. And it would be nice if somebody did that on MSNBC. I watched MSNBC afterwards, and I love MSNBC. It's fun. It's great entertainment. In order to get the information that I provided in 30 minutes, you had to watch 4 hours of MSNBC to get the same information that I gave you in 30 minutes. And that's not the nature of television versus podcasts. That's a network, a news network that knows what it's doing. It just dangles a little information in front of you, just enough to keep you addicted and with confrontation and ego and style over substance. If you listen to Friday's show, at the top of the show, I gave you all the information you needed to know, or what we knew about the Mueller report. That doesn't mean podcasts are better than television news. It means that television news really does not want to give you news. We're losing the art of journalism in this country. It should not be me telling you what the truth is. Then we had a great journalist on, Zach Ford from Think Progress, and we did an hour discussing the split between Bernie and the rest of the Democratic Party. And we got a lot of response to that, all favorable and very civil. I was very pleased that people disagree with me, or they disagree with Zach, and they were able to express themselves without name calling. You know, you cannot argue with a Republican. They're not honest interlocutors, and they're never going to tell you what they really believe. A Republican is never going to tell you they hate black people. And more studies are coming out that the reason Trump won is not because people who voted for him were falling behind economically. People voted for Trump because of racism, because of misogyny. There are countless studies that prove this. That Trump supporters truly are the deplorables. They truly are racist. The bedtime story we like to tell ourselves is, no, they don't have enough money. They're being marginalized by this economy. When in fact, every study that's come out since November of 2016 shows the reason Trump was able to get the votes he got is because he hated Mexicans and hated blacks and still does. And that's why people voted for him. So you're not going to be able to debate a Trump supporter because they're never going to tell you that. They're not honest debaters. What I'm finding is, thanks to the Bernie versus the rest of the Democratic Party conversation, we can begin to relearn how to discuss politics in this country. And I think if you listen to Friday's show, Zach and I had a fantastic conversation about Bernie versus the Center for American Progress, where Think Progress is housed. Bernie went after the Center for American Progress because the Center for American Progress is going after him. And Zach is not happy that Bernie's attacking his company. And Zach falls on the side of identity politics, whereas I fall on the side of class struggle. We're both Democrats. We both want the same exact things. We disagree on how we're going to get there. And I think you can have spirited conversations in this country among ourselves, not with Republicans, because they are dishonest. They will not tell you what they truly believe. There's a guy named Stephen Moore. Donald Trump wants this clown to sit on the Federal Reserve. He just took Herman Cain's name off the list. Herman Cain said, "Yeah, I don't want to be on the Federal Reserve." Actually, what he said is 999. You have to remember 2012 to get that joke. But that was his platform, 999. And it's a German joke. Okay, so Stephen Moore, Club for Growth, Wall Street Journal, Heritage Foundation, believes in the Laffer curve, believes in supply-side economics, even though supply-side economics proven that it doesn't work when they tried it in the Hoover administration. He's still pushing supply-side economics. And they've dug through some of his writings, and they have found that he's against democracy. He doesn't really think giving people the vote is that great an idea. He'll never tell you that, so you can't really debate him. And I remember watching Stephen Moore when I was working on the Bill Maher show in real time, HBO, and this clown would come on and he'd just start giggling and laughing because he doesn't really traffic in facts. He traffics in the purity of his truth. And his truth is rich people deserve to be rich. And in order to be rich, we need poor people to service the rich. That's the way it is. It's the luck of the draw. I cash my checks from rich people. The more I defend rich people, the more money I'm going to make. So I'll tell you anything to push what I consider my truth, facts be damned. He doesn't live in a fact-based world. That's why he was able to write editorials for the Wall Street Journal, and that's why he went over to the Heritage Foundation, which is a think tank set up by the Koch brothers to push their truth, just not facts, because facts get in the way of the deep, deeper truth that tax cuts for the rich benefit the whole country, because that's the truth we want to believe. That's the truth we want to believe. That's our truth. Whatever facts you throw in my face, it doesn't mean anything. So I'm, you know, trying to figure out how to do this show as the election approaches. Do I want to have arguments on the show, or do I want to give you the truth? And do you arrive at the truth through arguments, or do you arrive at the truth by reporting the truth? I think it's both. What I'm finding is that it's interesting talking to people in our own party, because we can have a conversation, an honest conversation with other Democrats. I can talk to a Biden supporter. Now, I'm a Bernie supporter. I've gotten a lot of letters from women who call themselves Bernie bros. I was going to say Bernie hoes. That's probably not politically correct, and probably not. I would assume somebody already came up with that. But there are a lot of Bernie sisters out there who have seen no value to the window dressing of a female president they see the importance of Bernie because he's true to his word. He's been a socialist all his life. And, you know, a lot of this split between Bernie and the Hillary supporters has been amplified by Twitter. It's been amplified by the media. It's been amplified on the coasts. But when you get into the heartland and you see where Bernie is strong, he has a primarily white crowd showing up to hear him speak. But the polls show him leading among Hispanics, among women, and African Americans. So if the Bernie bros are white incels, it's unfortunate, but they're only part of the Bernie coalition. Polling shows that it's a much wider cross-section of the American people. We can have a conversation, I hope, in the future with Hillary supporters. I don't hate Hillary. I wasn't fanatical about her in 2016 because I assumed she was going to win. I voted for her. I originally voted for Bernie, but I wasn't like crazy for Hillary. Enough time has passed looking back, and I'm beginning to realize that Bernie was the better candidate. I should have had more faith in the country and in the Democratic Party and more contempt for the ruling class than I did in 2016. That Bernie was saying things, and I voted for him. I'm just talking about, you know, the general election. There were things that Bernie was saying that Hillary is not saying. She and Biden, thank you for your service to the Democratic Party. We're now progressing because we are a party of progressives, and we've moved past your neoliberal ideology. And it's important that you know that what neoliberal means, it was formulated by the Austrian school of economists in Switzerland in the lead up to World War II. Hayek, and I think his name was Mises. I don't, you know, my pronunciation is terrible, but Hayek, who's the, you know, father of Milton Friedman's theories about shocking the system and the Chicago school and the Straussian economics. Neoliberals come to us from Hayek, and they believe that democracy is a threat. You know, neoliberalism was invented before World War II, during a period when a lot of countries in Europe were throwing out the monarchies and bringing democracy, freedom, to the Western world. You know, democracy was an anomaly. It was France, the United States, and Great Britain, a little in Germany, but the democracy was really spreading after World War I. And Hayek and the new neoliberal school of economics worried that democracy was going to destroy capital. It was going to destroy the economy because it gave too much power to the people to decide the trajectory of an economy, that it had to be taken away from the people. So neoliberalism pushes globalism and the protection of property, primarily capital, from the vicissitudes of a democracy. So when Obama and the Clintons, who really embraced neoliberalism, when they embraced neoliberalism, NAFTA, the Pacific trade deal, what Obama and Clinton were saying is, you can vote on everything, just not the direction of our economy. That is a basic core neoliberal tenet, that democracies are not safe for capital. And we have to take the power of self-determination when it comes to our economy. We have to take the power of self-determination away from the voters. That's what Hillary believes. That's what Obama believes. That the American people, or people in general, should not be trusted with the economy. That's why Congress never passes a stimulus bill unless the market is completely tanked. In 2009, when they broke the economy, we passed a stimulus bill. But it's mostly left, the economy, the direction of the economy is left to the Federal Reserve. They decide how to fine-tune it. not Congress, not the American people, the central bankers, the Federal Reserve. There's nothing democratic about the Federal Reserve. It's bankers who work for other bankers, and they're part of the international banking system. That's neoliberalism. That's what Hillary, Obama, and Biden believe in. Pete Buttigieg, or however you pronounce his name, he believes in that. That's what they believe. Now, you can have everything else in their mind. You can have everything else that liberals want, but you cannot control your economic fate. That's in the hands of the Federal Reserve and the central bankers. That's neoliberalism. That's why our economy for 99% of the country and the world, we're left with this apocalyptic moonscape of an economy, because we don't get to vote. We don't get to decide how much unemployment we should live with versus how much inflation there should be. That's been taken out of our hands. And that's a recent phenomenon. That's only happened really since Clinton. It started under Reagan, but we had a Democratic Party that wasn't neoliberal. We had a Democratic Party that represented labor and the people. You had Tip O'Neill running the Democratic Party when Reagan was president. So it wasn't until Clinton in 92, when he embraced neoliberalism, that we completely lost control of our economy. We turned it over to the central bankers, the third way. That's what Tony Blair did in Great Britain. He was supposedly elected by labor, the liberals, but no. The third way was, tell me what the central bankers want, and I'll do what they say. That wasn't going on in the 70s, wasn't going on in the 60s. This is a new phenomenon. What we're living through now is the fruition of neoliberal policies. On the show today, we have Professor Ben Burgess. He's a philosophy professor, and he teaches argument at Rutgers. He has a new book out. It's called Give Them an Argument, Logic for the Left. It's published by Zero Books. And Ben is voting for Bernie. He's a Marxist. And we're going to talk about how do you best arrive at the truth on today's show. Do you do it best by arguing and fighting, or is it better if somebody is reporting the news, doing a monologue? There was the debate of the century last week between Jordan Peterson and, I apologize, let's call him Slavoj Zizek. He's a Slovenian professor. So there was this big debate that Ben Burgess and Michael Brooks were all excited about. And it was a debate between Jordan Peterson and Slavoj Zizek in Toronto, sold out. I know who Jordan Peterson is. I really don't know who Zizek is. Now, Jordan Peterson is a psychology professor. He's the new darling of the right. He opposes postmodernism, pushes the natural hierarchy of things. He believes that society naturally falls into classes, not because of greed or exploitation, but because of human nature. It's biology that determines our fate, not the greed of the ruling class. And he had this big debate with Zizek, who is a Slovenian philosopher with two PhDs. Both of them are leading experts on psychoanalysis. I mean, Jordan Peterson is a lot of flash, but he did teach psychology at Harvard. Not that that means anything, but he knows his stuff. So I was interested in the format. So Professor Ben Burgess was watching this, and Michael Brooks was watching it, and this is something I really don't pay enough attention to, intellectual debates. And it was a three-hour debate from Toronto, sold out, live-streamed. Everybody was excited about it. It was like Frasier versus Ali. I decided I was going to watch a rerun of it. I did on YouTube. So I just want to talk about the format and whether or not there's value to this type of debating. And I suggest that some of you watch this. You can skim it on YouTube. It's 3 hours. Each gentleman talked for 30 minutes. And then there were shorter rebuttals, about 10 minutes each to rebut. And finally, questions and answers. It was a boulabaisse of catchphrases, drips and dribbles of philosophy, adding up to absolutely nothing. And I felt in many ways it was a waste of my time. I know people enjoyed watching it. To me, it was tantamount to a baseball game. If sitting there, you wait for something to happen. But I found it to be a waste of time. And then I worry, and I'm going to talk to Professor Burgess about this, maybe I don't know how to watch a debate. I don't have a tolerance for debating. I don't enjoy watching debates because I've never seen a good one. I don't have the patience for Tucker Carlson when he debates his guest, or Chris Cuomo when he debates his guests. I have no stomach for Kellyanne Conway because, you know, you go see Kellyanne Conway going head-to-head with Chris Cuomo. She's making an argument on behalf of the president. The arguments are not sound, but they achieve this larger purpose for the White House, inoculating the president. Go see Rudy Giuliani making the rounds of the Sunday morning chat shows, insisting that it's not collusion because it's not a crime to take oppo research from a foreign government. By the way, after 9/11, Giuliani was America's mayor. And I remember his going before the UN after 9/11 and saying there's no more room for moral relativism in this world. No more gray areas. No more gray areas. No moral relativism. Now, all we hear from Giuliani is gray areas and moral relativism. It's amazing what 4 failed marriages will force a man to believe in. I'm concerned about how we arrive at the truth, how voters can be informed. You know, the idea of a debate, I find it's not satisfying to me because the idea of a debate now is a lawyer's version of a debate. And lawyers are paid to make an argument for the client. And a client in America has the right to an attorney, and it's the job of the attorney to make the best argument he possibly can with the evidence he has to work with. And that's what Kellyanne Conway is. She's a lawyer. Chris Cuomo's a lawyer. Rudy Giuliani, also a lawyer. Laura Ingraham is a lawyer. Rush Limbaugh comes from a family of lawyers. Tucker Carlson isn't a lawyer, but he's going to need one. But, you know, Tucker Carlson knows how to make that argument. He knows how to argue his case. And the cases that these people make have nothing to do with facts. Spin, dismissing what other people say, talking past what you're saying, all these rhetorical devices to hide the facts, to hide what the absolute truth is. We all have our truth, and it's immutable. We're not going to move on our truth. What I mean by deep truth is you cannot put any facts in front of me that will refute my truth. You know, it's been said about conservatives that they don't have facts, but they have the truth on our side. Kind of like religion is the truth. So there's no fact that you can present to a religious person that God doesn't exist because they have this truth about God and Jesus. And when you have a truth, and we all have our truths, we won't budge. Now, America's deepest truth is that this land belongs to us. We're not moving. No matter what you tell us, we're here, we're not moving. Go have that argument with the Native Americans. Because we could debate with the Native Americans, who does this land belong to? You can have an argument as to who the land belongs to, how it should be divided between the Native Americans and the rest of the country. But the bottom line for Americans who are not Native Americans, our deep truth is we're never giving it back to the indigenous Americans. We're not going to share it. We're going to do the least amount do and give the least amount that we have to. So whatever facts are thrown our way in an argument or a debate with Native Americans, there is no moral argument. There isn't an argument sound enough. There aren't enough facts to get us to step away from our truth. We're not going to share the land with the Native Americans. Most American citizens who are not Native Americans won't admit this. If you were to ask them to debate a Native American, they're not going to say, I'm not giving up anything. When we talk about Native Americans, and we don't anymore, there was a time before I was born when we had to figure out how to help them. Most American citizens would tell their leaders, do whatever it takes, but don't make me give up anything. Give them the casinos, pretend to negotiate, pretend to listen, pretend to care, offer something, but make sure I don't have to give up anything. And so it was a dishonest argument because we weren't willing to tell the Native Americans or ourselves what the truth is. And that is, we're not budging. It's identical to the problem with the debate over Medicare for All. It's a completely dishonest debate, unless you're Bernie. You know, the deep truth is Medicare for All would work, but only if the health insurance CEOs and the lobbyists stopped working. The truth of that argument against Medicare for All is, you know, if you're a health insurance company, I own these multi-billion dollar corporations, and I'm sorry, 60,000 Americans die each year because they're underinsured, but I like what I have. I like money. I'm going to say and do anything and allow 60,000 Americans to die each year so long as I get to be in the health insurance business. So I'll pretend to listen to you. I'll pretend to negotiate. And I'll say things like, let's work together to make it a little better for you, but just make sure I get to keep everything and more. So I don't know what arguing gets us. I don't know. And I don't know how it benefits our democracy. It brings me back to that big debate between Jordan Peterson and Zizek. I'm not sure that that format in Toronto works for most Americans. The same way Chris Cuomo going back and forth with Kellyanne Conway also doesn't work. And I think the problem with debating, what we're seeing on TV news, is the adversarial approach to finding out the truth. This is an American conceit. We use the adversarial approach where each side makes its case in the courtroom. The judge and the jury, for the most part, sit there and listen. The judge, at best, is a referee, but she keeps her mouth shut. This is very different from the inquisitional system used in most of Europe and parts of Asia. Their criminal justice system is different than ours. It's inquisitional. There's a judge or a panel of three judges, and they grill the prosecutor, the defense lawyers, and the witnesses. It's like an inquest. We see this in the Supreme Court. When you argue a case before the Supreme Court, that's an inquisition. That's the inquisitional system, sort of, at play here, where the nine justices are grilling the two lawyers. And I think debating celebrates the adversarial system for arriving at the truth. And I'm not so sure the adversarial system works, because the adversarial system, you just say whatever you have to. You make the argument to win it, and nobody's interrupting you. No judge, inquisitor, is asking you to back up your arguments. I don't know, maybe we should try it on this show. Maybe the news network, they're never going to do it. The presidential debates used to have several reporters asking questions. Now it's always one guy, one woman asking the questions. It would be nice to see a presidential debate where you had a panel of inquisitors, kind of like Michael Cohen when he went before Elijah Cummings' House Oversight Committee. That was edifying. You were arriving at truths because you had an inquisitional system at play. You had Republicans and Democrats asking him tough questions. And then the viewer can decide what the truth is. You had these congressmen asking really tough questions or making really tough statements, and you could arrive at the truth by watching that. So I don't know how to change the conversation in America. Try slogging through this debate between Jordan Peterson and Zizek and see what you think. I think the debate format doesn't work anymore. A debating society like the Oxford Debating Society, they celebrate your ability to take whatever side is given to you. You win by making the best argument, not by telling the truth, but by making the best argument. I rather have inquisitors, judges, asking questions. I think a debate would be a lot more interesting to have somebody asking Jordan Peterson and Zizek tough questions. That, to me, would be an interesting debate. Little less adversarial, more of an inquisition.